Oh, that synchronized so well. I mean, I meant to do that. Everything has gone according to plan. Except for the part where you haven't caught Jack the Ripper. That wasn't deliberate.
Oops. Oh, no.
But that's canon.
It is canon. I'm looking to preserve the stability of the...
timeline.
Of the timeline.
Right.
I'm here to protect the future by making sure that Jack the Ripper isn't caught.
We're doing the Don't Solve the Case speed run that was... Right now they're like...
I mean, couldn't I just do that from the beginning of the game?
That's true.
Just be like, I'll solve it!
It's a 100% don't solve the case.
Yes, exactly, exactly. Gosh, goodness, goodness. So, hi, welcome. This is Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective, where we're trying to solve a murder, several murders, many murders in this particular instance. And this particular episode is part two of Case 4, the finale of the Whitechapel saga, which this is a different book. I forgot that I have four books on the table. We're good. This is Mary Jane Kelly's murder, but it is also the last of the murders, so we're going to try and solve the whole business. And in fact, we've been put to that task very specifically by Sherlock Holmes himself. So, I was just catching Lobos Jr. up with. We began investigating Mary Jane Kelly specifically. In particular, we were trying to figure out time of death. We investigated a number of clues and went back to speak to Sherlock, got a little bit more information from him. We think we've got a pretty clear window of time of death now, but he's asked us to look at all of the cases, including one that we didn't investigate, which happened before the very first murder in this book. And we've got a bunch of information, and we need a lead. We're saying we're not even sure necessarily what questions they're going to ask. Are they going to ask, who is Jack the Ripper? Well, maybe, but they might just as likely be asking, who isn't Jack the Ripper?
Yeah, exactly.
And we still don't know.
I still don't know. Maybe we're all Jack the Ripper. Maybe we've all been Jack the Ripper the whole time.
Oh, jeez.
I do have what might be a slightly controversial suggestion, but I'll throw it out there.
Please do.
So we've been to a lot of places in Case 4.
Yes.
And if I remember right, the descriptions of the summary entries said we could review those cases at will.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's the same as any case.
Right. So I guess what I'm getting at is there any reason we shouldn't go to the questions now and at least find out what we're looking for, since we seem to be kind of at a dead end at the moment?
Oh, you mean flip to the questions?
Yeah. Because we're allowed to review all of our information during the question section. The only thing we can't do is go somewhere new. That's the only restriction once you enter.
I don't know that we know that we. There's not a new place we're going.
I'm 90% sure we just completely missed a hook. Like, there's some major hook.
Yeah, like
that we don't.
Yeah, I feel like the prompt from Sherlock in particular, and in a meta way, based on what we've seen Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective do before, is saying. Go find this hook, whether it's new or it's something that we've misplaced, and figure out here is this path that we need to take. I think that there's too much possibility for that in the questions.
I also
no, please go ahead.
Also, specifically, we have the sort of quote unquote soldier angle. And I'm not sure if we fully followed it to its end.
Tell me about the soldier angle.
So, the very first case, there were two soldiers who were not identified involved.
Martha Tabram.
Yes.
A woman of the night, paired up with Pearly Polly. I've gone through and just sort of updated all of our information just so we've got it handy. Not all of it, certainly. There's plenty of information left in the books. But Martha Tabram in particular, I wrote down a bunch because she happened before we started on the case. She was murdered around 3 to 3:30 in the morning on Tuesday, August 7th, 1888, near the George Yard building. She was found around 4:45 by a local resident, Saunders Reeves. She had spent the evening in the company of a fellow prostitute, Pearly Paul. They had been palling around with two soldiers. They split. They went their separate ways around 11:45. She was found in the stairway of the apartment building. She'd been stabbed 39 times, 38 times by a small penknife, mostly in her chest and abdomen, and once with a bayonet or some other long blade in the chest and the sternum. Now, she was found in the stairway. Neighbors who were coming home very late that night said they saw nothing in the stairway around 2 a.m., but then someone else who was coming home around 3:30 spotted the body in the stairway, but thought it was just someone sleeping. So...
Was this one... Because I've only been here for the one case at the beginning of this.
Right.
And it had a particular, like... description to it as if the body had been moved or fixed up or,
yes.
like... Like, because there wasn't blood just everywhere.
There was a pool of blood. It was not
okay.
so explosive as some of the other cases that we found, but there was a lot of blood.
Okay.
Given what we've seen of a little bit of the other victims, I wonder if maybe... I don't know. Conjecture is dangerous, I know, but I wonder if maybe she was stabbed for some reason by... someone with a bayonet and left to die, and then someone who came across her or was following saw an opportunity and went in to stab her a bunch after the fact. Not sure. I don't know.
My gut feeling, which again is not how we're supposed to make decisions.
Yeah, we've been bitten for that before.
At this point, like, all of these cases were probably committed by the same person.
Sure.
Right.
I hope so.
And... I'm guessing that there probably aren't too... Like, I feel like it's too much of a swerve for the first case to have two people involved.
Okay.
But I was curious what we could learn about, you know, like, who would have a bayonet and, you know, be in that area and things like that.
What were you asking, Rachel?
Oh, I was curious. There was a letter that Jack the Ripper wrote that we're pretty sure was by Jack the Ripper. And I was wanting to reread that.
So he spoke to a doctor at the medical center at the hospital who gave us a letter that the police did not have.
They haven't analyzed it yet.
Right.
Yes. Can I reread that real quick, Harvey? You're not in book four.
I think that's
four.
That's murder four. So, yeah, this one.
Okay. Yeah.
This one. So I'll be looking for E92.
Yes, indeed.
So in the, I guess, the second murder, but the first case, wasn't there also some, we were thinking about the idea of her being dead and then somebody coming by later and finding and then doing something with the body?
Right, that's what I just proposed.
Right. But that was for, like, the first case, though, right?
That is something that we were wondering about, but okay. It turns out we were wrong.
Oh.
The evidence suggests that it was just that same person.
Okay.
That slit her throat and then took care of it themselves.
All right.
Yeah. So, a couple other things that I noticed as I was compiling this data is that the frying pan is definitely a regular port of call for these ladies, which means that if someone was on the prowl for a prostitute to murder... then they might be frequent hanger about at that location.
Oh.
Also, it doesn't look like whoever did this did any murders in all of October. Which is kind of peculiar when you consider that a lot of the other ones are like a week or a couple of weeks apart from one another. Mm-hmm. And so that got me wondering if there was like some particular, like, if they were... an actual sailor, as someone described them in the case of Catherine Eddowes, I think. If they were on a ship that happened to be out of town for all of October, perhaps that would explain why the dry season.
One note, the letter that we do believe he wrote, because he knew about the kidney there.
Right.
And sending half the kidney. The letter was when he sent half of the kidney.
Yes.
And that's like, well, that's kind of specific.
Mm-hmm.
The letter was received October 29th at the hospital.
Okay.
So that does, that is late into it. When was the article about the kidney written? If the letter came before or after the newspaper started writing about a kidney, because there was like that fake article where like, oh, Bright's disease and all these things know from a kidney.
Yeah, I feel like that's in the November papers, wherever that is.
Oh, I've got that.
Just,
Can we very briefly do a description of the other murders? Just sure.
Reputed graphologist, expert in writing.
Oh, finally!
Able to detect personality or compare documents for purposes of authentication. Make an appointment with the landlady of Mr. Jonathan Weatherwax, 56 Bath Terrace.
We've been desperately looking.
That was something we really were looking for.
But I think just because we were so tired, couldn't find, no matter where we looked, a graphologist to study the handwriting of the letter that we're now in possession of.
And the letter arrived during this session. This final mystery, or
the comparison was during this one. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Scotland Yard is in possession of, like, tons of letters, but this particular one has been sent to a graphologist, and then we have this one that the doctor gave us.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, yeah, just really quickly, Martha Tabram was murdered Tuesday, August 7th. That was the one that was stabbed 39 times. Mm-hmm. This is the first case that we worked on, which is the lady whose throat was slit and was found by the couple of carters. Mm-hmm. Then we had this one who someone spotted very early in the morning, went into a yard with a man. Someone heard a scuffle and was discovered like literally right before dawn in the yard.
Okay.
Number four was discovered like 5 minutes after she was murdered. Someone found an apron out in the yard. Someone had written up in blood on the walls or something like that. I can't believe we haven't heard more about that. That's kind of weird.
What did they write?
It was
like something long, or
it wasn't that long, but it was ominous. Unless I'm remembering completely incorrectly. And then this one, the one that they're working on right now, Mary Jane Kelly, was murdered in her apartment room, and it was like a really grisly, like Silent Hill level gore.
It was.
In addition, they
literally said organs everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fair enough.
On top of which, there was a fireplace that apparently had been lit with fire so hot that it had melted part of the kettle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We know that some of the clothes were burned in that fire, which was the whole thing of that clothing has been moving around strangely. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And the guy is always wearing a different outfit. Okay. I believe.
Just based on eyewitnesses that may have seen him?
It seems like there's always an eyewitness of the last John. And then,
although that's not always someone that matches this description.
Yeah.
Did you have something else, Rachel?
No.
Where am I going?
Graphologist.
Right.
The newspaper that had him was borrowed.
Which
newspaper? Yeah,
I think it was September 10th.
Right?
56 Bath Terrace, Southeast.
Yep.
56 Southeast, I think.
56 Southeast. Let's take a look. Maybe he's Jack the Ripper.
The graphologist.
Versus foiled again.
Jonathan Weatherwax is amused by our visits. I have the impression that a sensational murder is... Wait, I've already used this voice for some of this campaign.
Oh, no.
I have the impression that a sensational murder is needed for people who would be interested in graphology. Wait one moment. Oh, here's the abominable letter that Mr. Lestrade from Scotland Yard personally delivered. I've compared it to many others, and the writing can be linked to none. Oh. It also contained a large number of mistakes. And again, these mistakes seemed artificial, and the writing voluntarily changed. This letter isn't signed. See for yourselves, gentlemen. And then there's a actual letter addressed from hell to a Mr. Lusk. I think this might be a photograph of an actual letter received by the... I almost said Boston?
Boston Yard. That went to the head of the defense group.
This is the one that Scotland Yard brought to them.
And
yes.
It supposedly also had a kidney with that one. So I think there's two kidney letters. One half a kidney and one full kidney. That was one of the things that I was starting to read up on him.
Maybe, I mean, too. Well, there's lots more here, so let's see what he thinks.
Yes.
Thankfully, they actually print the information. From hell, Mr. Lusk. Sir, I send you half the kidney, spelled K-I-D-N-I, I took from one of these women, preserved just for you. The other piece I fried and ate. It was grat. I might send you the bloody knife that cut it out if you wait a tad longer.
What?
Signed, Catch Me If You Can, Mr. Lusk. I don't remember who Lusk is. Does anyone else?
Lusk was the head of the defense. I thought he lied to us before about something. Like, he was trying to be famous, but I might be misremembering.
I thought he was the head of the defense group.
Yeah, I thought that there was...
Head of the... like, the EDF?
The Vigilance Committee.
The Vigilance Committee, yeah.
The Vigilance Committee, okay.
Don't remember anything about him lying to us, though. I thought that was the newspaper guy.
So, here's the article about him receiving that letter.
Got it. The postal stamp leads me to believe it was posted from the east of the Whitechapel neighborhood. Now, look at this postcard. It was addressed to the Central News Office. London City EC, October 1st. I wasn't kidding, dear boss, when I gave you that tip. You'll hear about the work of the Cheeky Jackie tomorrow. With a double number, this time number one squeaked a bit, couldn't finish right away. No time to give the ears to the cops. Thanks for having kept my letter long enough for me to get back to work. Signed, Jack the Ripper. Writing on the front of the card, the address resembles the one in the letter from September 25th quite a bit, and the card refers to it. But look at the writing on the back. The text seems to have been written by a different hand. The white writing is more sustained, the space between words is more pronounced. The inclination has disappeared. It's less expansive, more cramped. Writing from the letter of the 25th was all in curves, with a slight uniform inclination to the right. It's obviously the work of someone more cultured. Nonetheless, this card and the Dear Boss letter are all the more surprising that the nickname Jack the Ripper hadn't yet been divulged to the press. I'll also bring your attention to the London EC stamp, which isn't the one used in the Whitechapel or the Spitalfields neighborhoods. All this is quite strange, as if, on these last two hands had worked together to mislead the police. I think it's fake, and it is in utmost bad taste. So do we, and for the From Hell letter. Who knows? Maybe the real Jack found himself some letter-writing talent.
Interesting, and yet...
Interesting. Not the atom bomb that we were hoping for, I think. But perhaps investigating the EC post office might be worthwhile.
Indeed.
Unless someone happened to be in possession of an enormous number of EC stamps.
Well, 93 EC is the post office. I don't think we've been there.
I don't think so either.
Not this one, anyway. Nope, I don't see it.
Do we want to try... to visit this highly Yelp-rated post office?
We went to see the stamp thief, and he was useless.
He was useless. Thank you, Rachel.
Disappointingly useless. I was like all set for that to be the big reveal, the crack on the case.
It's true. I did it for the stamps. I cut women open to pull the stamps out of them. That's where they come from, right? Well,
no!
Whoa.
Well, to be clear, he wasn't actually the stamp thief. He was an idiot who bought the stamps from a thief and then had the bright idea of trying to sell them back to the same post office they'd been stolen from.
Yes, indeed.
Fair enough.
Oh, are we going to...
93 EC, my good man.
There's no 93.
Well... Much for that.
Okay. Well. I guess we could go back to being detectives.
Can I see the back of the... Well, no, that's not what it is. Never mind.
What were you thinking?
I was trying to think of, like, if there's any more resources that would have... information about...
These are safe to just, like, read the answers of, right?
Yes.
Okay, just want to make sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, just check them out.
What about the Central News Agency that received the letter in the first place?
That's fair.
I don't think we've been there.
So, yeah, they said we had two halves of kidneys get mailed out, but one of the halves of kidney, they said he ate the other half.
63.
It just showed up.
63 EC, yeah.
Not see. Wait, that's Northwest. Oh boy, it's good time. EC 63.
63 EC.
No, sorry.
What about 25 EC, which is the Central Press Syndicate?
25. Oh, there is something at 25 EC.
Excellent.
Cool. We find Joseph Barnett in his home, apparently beside himself, considering how much... Wait, have we been here yet?
25, you see?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we have. Oops.
But how is that also the Central Press Syndicate? That's very strange.
It's probably one of those things where it's listed under his name and that location, because they do that sometimes. Oh. Like,
they'll do like a block
maybe.
Sometimes.
But yeah, we went there as Joseph Barnett. I would never even thought of it as the central thingy.
Yeah. We went there and got clues about where Maria might be.
Okay.
Yeah.
And he was very sad.
There it is. Yeah, anything could be there. Nuts!
Yeah.
Humph! Oh. Well...
do we have November's newspaper handy?
I have it.
Yeah.
September. November.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, you're right. I've tried to refresh myself on what happened at the end of the previous one.
What other, what else don't we know other than the identity of Jack the Ripper?
We still haven't identified how... One of the things that Holmes pointed out was how this person was able to essentially look like they belonged there in all of these situations.
Yeah.
And that would probably be part of the pattern, especially looking at the dates and times and the hows.
Is there another laundry place? Like, that sounded like he was stealing clothes from the laundry place, but we never got a solid lead from that.
But even if you had access to a laundromat of clothes, how would you... I guess I'm trying to figure out what would you wear that would make it look like you belonged there in the middle of the night?
Officer's uniform?
That was one of the crazy theories I think I had at some point, but I think it was just...
But no one's ever described, like, oh, there was a policeman there.
Yeah.
Well, there were officers making the rounds.
There were,
at some of these situations. And I remember, particularly in this first case, or maybe it was either the first or the second, where you had two officers from different directions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was the first one.
And one of them kind of ran off and wasn't entirely clear.
One was, like, helping, like, some there was, like, a drunk vagrant or something, and they came and told him, and he was like, whatever, and, like, kind of ignored it.
Yeah, and it, that feels like, kind of suspicious. And, like, my other thing, just in terms of, like, I think it was the times, maybe, that if you were to, like, look at some of the times in relation to, like, that police station, they'd almost look like that's about how much, distance is based on some kind of route, maybe.
Well, I mean, we can re-look at those entries. We've got them listed right here.
Again, he did tell us to focus on the times, or look for patterns.
He said to look for patterns.
Yeah.
So, you could speak to... Officer Neal, who, so they...
Right, we did talk to both of them.
Yeah, and it lists all their entries right here. So, two people, Charles Cross and Robert Paul, Carters, found the body of Polly, ran off to find the cops. Right after they left, Officer Neal showed up. Then they met Officer Meisen, informed him of the body, and then Meisen eventually showed up. So Officer Neal is at 123 East, and then... Meisen is at 126 East.
123
East.
Sorry. When I repeated that back, I'm like, that couldn't be right. Officer Neal is recovering from his long night shift. And it does seem like whoever this is awake late at night. At least on the weekends.
And at least once on a Tuesday.
Yeah, the Tuesday.
Well, the Tuesday was the first one.
Sure. That we know of.
Well, yeah. Very, very good point. Sorry, Mr. Neal, apologizes Wiggins, but we'll only take a few minutes. We follow Officer Neal into his modest apartment. He sits down, smooths his mustache, and tries to put some order to his messy hair. What would you like to know, gentlemen? Just a few details. Can you describe the state the body was in when you found it? That poor woman was lying on her back alongside a wooden door with her left side against it and her throat slit. As I didn't see much blood, I took a bit of time to realize she was dead and even tried to pull her back up. How was it that you didn't see more blood? Wiggins asks, surprised.
At first, I thought she had been killed elsewhere and dropped off here, so I looked for wheel marks with the light of my lantern, but found none. When then colleagues arrived, then Dr. Leowen, who lives not too far off on Whitechapel Road, the doctor quickly examined the body, had it transported to the morgue in a hand-pulled cart. It's then that we lifted the corpse and put it in the wooden shell that we realized there was a mass of coagulated blood at head height and that the victim's clothes were largely soaked in it. You didn't see anyone as you arrived? I was making my round from Baker's Row to Brady Street, and no, I didn't see anyone. And then there's was that the one where there's another officer who was talking about a vagrant? That was somewhere.
Right, that was 126. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
So she was likely killed there and just bleeding there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Listen, I don't know who at the yard is sending you, but I like not having to endlessly repeat the same things. With a sigh, Jonas Meisen unwillingly remembers the night of the murder. I was patrolling on Hanbury when, at the crossing with Old Montague, two carters stopped me. One of them told me that my services were required at Buck's Row, and after receiving a bit more information, I left in that direction. I found another officer there, Neil, with locals. I helped as much as I could at the moment, went to fetch the medical examiner, and once the body was transported, I returned home.
Well. So, something else that came up during this case that I don't think we ever really reconciled was that there was some kind of a discrepancy in the autopsy report.
Yeah, about the locations of the organs in the room, as if someone had moved them around between when they were first seen and when the report was written.
Right. That would actually suggest, perhaps, that someone with access to the place, which was completely surrounded by the police, they wouldn't even let us in, had availability to interfere with things.
Did it seem like there was any reason for moving the organs?
Not really.
No.
No.
They were just put in different random places instead of the original random places.
Yeah. Nightstands versus I think she was holding them.
Something like that. Could have been a journalist trying to make a more sensational thing, although frankly, as sensational as it already was, it seems ridiculous to think you would feel the need to move things around for some added boost.
It may have been a sloppy report. Or a bug in the game as it was written.
But I do remember like body parts that were listed on as being on top of furniture in one report and being
it seemed very deliberate.
It was very specific about that, and very specific that they were in different places in the different reports.
Mm-hmm. You could always go see the psychic.
Oh!
Robert James Lee, the famous medium from Peckham, grand expert in divination, offers seances at his residence to help those who have great difficulty in making the right choices for all sorts of demands.
Yes!
Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
Please.
We're going to a psychic.
All right. What's their address?
53 SW.
All right, well.
Oh, I'm reading the psychic.
Oh, God, yes you are.
Thank you. 53 SW?
Yep.
53 SW.
Right. It's Sherlock in a turban. I'm very disappointed with you.
Oh, thank you. It's good to see you again. It's two steps away from the Russian embassy that we find Robert James Lee in a small, modestly furnished apartment after having had some trouble convincing the medium's cantankerous landlady to let us in. His face is worrisome and his gaze makes us feel ill at ease. He holds in his right hand a fob watch connected to his pocket by a small gold chain, which he handles as he looks at us. Wiggins explains the reason for our visit, and then he speaks.
Wait, what is that, Wiggins?
It doesn't say what Wiggins says. I'm actually disappointed. I wanted to hear the whole thing. I currently work in Peckham, he explains to us emphatically, and it's while I was coming home on the night of the murder that I had a vision that a new crime would take place. Having read yesterday morning in the papers the confirmation of what I had foreseen, I went to see the police, who unfortunately didn't fully comprehend the vital importance of my testimony.
Were you able to identify the murderer in your vision? Asks Wiggins dubiously. I wouldn't be able to tell you who it was, as I had never seen him before. However, I'd certainly recognize him again if I met him in the street. He's a brown-haired man of average size with graying sideburns in his 50s. He doesn't wear a mustache and is a doctor.
This is a fake psychic, Rachel. Don't look at me as if this is a clue.
It is a clue.
He's already contradicted things we know for certain.
How do you know? Asks Wiggins in a surprised tone. Robert James Lee puts his watch away and wipes his forehead with a handkerchief that he pulls out of his pocket. It seems the action of remembering his vision tires him. He feverishly grabs a crystal carafe placed on a small table within reach and pours himself a glass of water, which he drinks with a disconcerting slowness. That's a lot of flavor text in the middle of
this. It's good, I love this.
I saw her, the poor girl, cut up in pieces, he ends up explaining to us after a long silence. There are flashes, brief and painful, visions of horror during which I've been unable to discern the work of a confirmed anatomist. Painful visions of horror during which I've been able to discern the work of a confirmed anatomist. Can you tell us more? I can attempt to enter a mystical trance.
Yes.
In order to try and localize the residence of that doctor. But I can't be sure to succeed, and it would exhaust me for the day. It's of the utmost importance to us. We can't neglect a lead coming from such an eminent medium as you, insists Wiggins wily. Willily. Willily?
No.
Why Lily? Why, Lily? Of course, we'd agree to financially compensate you for your performance.
Like how he called it a performance.
Yes. He pours himself another glass, still without offering us one, delicately dabs his temples with his handkerchief, then places his hands on his knees and raises his eyes to the ceiling until they go completely white, then closes them softly. We remain as quiet as possible, barely daring to breathe. After many long minutes, he begins to twitch, mutters inaudible words, then comes back to himself. Evidently drained, he pulls out the handkerchief again, pours himself two more glasses of water, thus emptying the carafe. We look at him, without daring to break the silence, hanging on to his every word. He lives in Mayfair. I saw a large avenue, Brook Street, NW, a personal hotel not far from a small park. That house, it's his! Robert James Lee clutches the armrests of his chair, clearly out of strain. Forgive me, gentlemen, but I need to lie down. I think these are all good.
The game is on!
The game is afoot! Okay, we found him.
What do they say?
We know the doctor.
Brooks. There's Brook Street. Wait, was it Brook Street?
I thought it was in Northwest.
Oh.
Yeah, it's NW.
Oh.
Maya, isn't it called a stepladder?
What?
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 I don't know. We were conducting spirit mediums for our investigation.
Oh.
So.
Oh, dang it. Yeah. Tell it again in like 15 minutes. I'll pick up what you're putting down.
I still haven't picked it up.
You haven't played the games that it's from. We established that last week, actually.
Oh!
Yeah.
Wonderful. I don't remember the games.
You don't remember anything.
I'm great at this game. Why did you invite me? Twice!
There's Brook Street.
Yeah, there we go. Brook Street. There's a garden.
And it's across from the garden.
There. There's a hotel. 30 Northwest.
Yes!
Lobos, take us there.
This seems like a really good way.
See if Jack the Ripper lives there.
Negative points.
I think we're deep enough in the hole that we should go everywhere.
Do we just want to go in order?
We go door to door through all of London. Hello, are you Jack the Ripper?
No, sure 30.
Oh.
There's 29 now.
29.
Yes. We're walking in the area around Grosvenor Square.
Yep.
We're going down Brook Street, and we can't help but notice the rich residence at 76 on that same street. We ask a merchant who the house belongs to, Sir William Gull, a clinician close to royalty.
We found a doctor out there?
Maybe this is just a doctor that the medium wants put in jail.
There's 76.
So he tells a bunch of street urchins about it.
I mean, we're here.
True.
All right. We ring at the door of a nice house in the upper-class neighborhood of Grosvenor Square.
A man covered with blood and uteruses answers the door.
A small woman, old but forceful, introduces herself to us as the wife of Sir William Gull. She ends up losing her patience while listening to the dubious arguments of our dear Wiggins, whom we've seen more inspired. That's completely ridiculous, gentlemen. My husband has a poor opinion of the charlatans who practice divination. Could you at least tell us where we could find him? Attempts Wiggins. Listen, young man, my husband is 71 years old and is recently... A man with a severe gaze bearing long gray sideburns appears. What's happening, Liz? Wiggins attempts as best as he can.
Excuse me, sir, we think you're Jack the Ripper. Could you tell us if we're on to something?
To save face and is reduced to asking his opinion as to the medical knowledge the murderer of the East End might possibly have. I wouldn't know what to tell you, gentlemen. You should ask the doctors who have autopsied the victims. Why come to see me? Robert James Lee, the famous medium, had a vision in which you appeared, begins Wiggins unconvincingly. Interesting, very interesting. And under what light did I appear in that vision? Answers Sir William Gull condescendingly. Surprisingly, as an important witness. One of Dr. Gull's bushy eyebrows rises on his forehead. Fascinating, and I would have kept that important testimony for myself because we just happened to want to talk to you about it, answers a Wiggins, who's running low on arguments. I understand, Mr. Wiggins, and these here are my collaborators. Mr. Wiggins, do you often call upon divination to lead your investigations? No, doctor.
Know this guy.
No, doctor, it's the first time. Well, try to make sure it's the last, young man, growls the imminent Dr. Gold before suddenly closing the door.
That is delightful.
Well, that's exactly that is where that should have gone.
Yes.
I'm relieved that the game didn't make you go to person like that to find anything of relevance. Yeah, now, had the game given you another...
Do you think this is a game?
Yes. I mean...
Oh.
It fits the game theory stuff, so...
I love game theory. Gosh. Aberdeen Navigation Company. Regular departures for all of the large cities in Europe. Special fares for steamers heading to the Mediterranean. Bordeaux. Lisbon. Malagala, Algiers, Barcelona, Palermo, Naples, Tunis, Tripoli, Athens, Alexandria, and Port Said. Daily shuttles for Le Fervre, Le Havre, in France. Cabins with all comfort at prices defying all competition. Inquire with the agency for more information up at Thames Street, 26 EC.
Wasn't that where we found out that what's-his-name had gone to Paris and couldn't have been the suspect?
Maybe. Do we have it on the list?
Oh, well, I think that was from the third one, though, wasn't it?
Oh, maybe.
Yeah,
yeah, Walter Ocelot didn't do it. Because
he was in Paris.
Right.
Hitched a thing out of town.
Yes. Where's, can I see the book, please? Thank you.
That's the solution.
Consider the time, the day, and the location of the crimes. If you look more closely at each of these elements, you could pair some of these crimes or the opposite, isolate one. This will give us information on the murderer's profile and his habits. Thanks to the information you've just given me about the death of Mary Jane Kelly, which is that she was murdered after 4 because fellow Antoni Preccia happened to be with her until 4. A chronology is beginning to take shape. Come on, gentlemen, we're reaching our goal.
Yeah, the isolated one was the first one.
Yeah, it was the only one that wasn't on a Friday, Saturday, or Sunday.
And we dug into that one. We couldn't find anything.
They all took place relatively early in the morning, late in the evening kind of times. Not terribly consistent within that, unfortunately. Some as early as 1:40, some as late as possibly 6 in the morning.
Right.
One that was almost in broad daylight. They took...
But how many were not, were like later? Like, I don't know, is there... a clump that were around a more similar time?
Three 3:30 Tuesday, an unknown time on a Friday, 5:20 Saturday, 1:40 Sunday, and sometime between 4 and 6 Friday.
I think that the ones on this street were at a certain time, and these two were at a similar time. That seemed to be like a flood.
Which ones? So number one was 3:30 on a Tuesday. That was here.
Number one we managed to narrow a little bit.
This is actually number two, technically. It was the first case, but that's...
Yeah, that's...
there we go.
I'm sorry, I meant number two.
Oh, sorry, number two.
So, she was found at 3:30, and the body was still warm.
Okay.
So it must have been sometime between 3 and 3:30, I think. 3-ish.
So that was there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, in that case, if that's true, then the standouts possibly would be the 1:40 Sunday one, because it's so much earlier than the rest. It's
right.
The only one that's not between, mm-hmm. like, 3 and 6. And
which
that
one
was
is that?
Number four, which is...
Catherine Eddowes. Was spotted in the company, supposedly, of the murder by the two folks going to the Imperial Club.
So do we want to go there
again?
Yeah,
can we review number four? Because that one's interesting, because there was another murder that night that was unrelated.
So, there was.
Yeah, it was over there.
Catherine Eddowes was killed. This is just a recap, so
yeah.
I'll just read it since I have the book.
Okay.
If we go somewhere new, I'll pass it back. Catherine Eddowes was killed on Sunday, September 30th, 1888, around 1:40 in the morning. She was aged 46 and measured 4 feet 11 inches. Her body was discovered at 1:45 a.m. in a dark corner by Constable Watkins, who was making his rounds. Mitre Square isn't lit. The body was lying on its back, throat slit, mutilated, and eviscerated. The intestines were removed from the body, and the murderer had gashed the eyes of the victim, cut off her right ear and part of her nose. He removed her left kidney and her uterus and took them with him. Medical examiner Brown arrived on the location around 2 a.m. and estimates that no more than 5 minutes were needed to perform these mutilations, despite them being numerous. Witnesses Lewandi and Levy met the victim and the probable killer as they were going to the Imperial Club, north of Mitre Square, with the objective of playing cards at around 1:35 a.m. They formally identified the victim, but once again the killer had his back to them. He was wearing a gray cap with a visor and a red scarf, as well as a gray jacket. He was aged between 30 and 35 years old, wore a fine chestnut mustache, and gave the impression of being a sailor. A piece of white apron belonging to the victim was found a few streets to the northeast on Gulston Street. It was stained with blood, and the murderer probably wiped his hands with it before abandoning it on his escape. A bloody fountain was also found on Dorset Street. And there's testimony that you can find for Officer Watkins and the Imperial Club folks.
They were talking about organs being removed. What happened to them?
He took them with him.
So the bloody fountain.
I
actually don't remember that either.
Me either.
So, a handkerchief found somewhere on here that
yes.
was bloody, and then over here he washed his hands maybe? I don't know.
Yeah.
I
would have assumed he would have wrapped an organ... like a kidney or something in the handkerchief.
Right, oh, that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't eat them raw.
No, you stuff them in your cheeks
like a
chipmunk.
That's not where uteruses go.
Sometimes, some crimes.
Never.
Go slipping through the cracks.
Chip the
there's,
Ripper.
There's no gum shoes. They're going to pick up the
spot. Oh, I was just playing as Monterey Jack in an episode
that's
of Eldritch Horror last week.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I died. No, I didn't. I went insane.
That's
happened.
Right.
On the moon. Do we want to look in book three at the Dorset Street Fountain to see
what that
might have? I think it's that
I
book there.
Like
yeah, it should be this one.
Yeah.
Street
where's Dorset Street? Is that here? Do you want to check 96, excuse me.
96 which?
EC. No, yes, EC.
96 EC.
What about... You can check that more easily.
56 or 35 East.
56 or which?
Or 35.
35 or 56 E. 1 second. There's no 35. 56 is the other one. There is also no 56.
Hmm.
Where is this mysterious fountain? How did all of this blood get into this blood fountain?
I know who you are.
Is this covering a number by two? No. Okay.
No, I was very careful.
Pretty small street.
Mm-hmm.
Rumors.
Train station. Train station under construction, but a train station
is
still.
The train was still running.
It was. There were trains heard that night.
Yes.
Could be onto something.
Where's the directory?
It's in this big stack in front of me. Excuse me.
Trains. That is a definite pattern, though.
There is a.
They're all like within a couple blocks of the train.
There is a Whitechapel station in addition to the ones listed there.
Want to give a look?
Sure. 102E. If not, we'll just hit some of them until we get one. Yep. 102E looks like a strikeout, yeah. But let's try one that's actually possibly relevant.
So 9 is a possibility, 12, and 102.
That's what you just looked
at. Yeah, so I guess 9. Is this EC or
EC? EC.
EC, 9 EC. Nope. No 9
EC.
And which one?
12 EC.
Also nothing for 12 EC.
Maybe the train has a headquarters or office or something like that.
Maybe. Let me look.
Do you go to the train
stations? Try and cross over. Liverpool Street, London. Liverpool Street. No, that's when we checked. It's 104, 107. A lot of them are very high numbers in the 100s, which don't exist in this.
Perhaps while you're looking, I can recount some information about the fountain, which I think we had heard about, but sort of got glossed over. This is from the interview with Edward Watkins, who is the constable that discovered the body of Catherine Eddowes. By inspecting the area, my colleague found a piece of the victim's apron in Goulson Street. It was covered in blood. It was brought to Dr. Brown. Another colleague who had joined him discovered that the Dorset Street public fountain was still red from the blood left by the murderer. We also found an inscription right next to where the apron piece was found at 102, I think, on the passage's wall of black bricks. The inscription which said, "The Jews will not be men who will be accused for nothing. I beseech you, gentlemen, don't repeat that to the journalists. My superiors learned that I gave you this information. It could cost me a great deal. Do you think it's the work of the killer? I don't know, but in any case, Superintendent Arnold, Head Inspector Swanson, and the Commissioner, Sir Charles Warren, decided to erase the inscription before dawn. It was actually us who splashed the buckets of water and scrubbed the wall to make it disappear. Why? All that's political. I don't get involved in any of that." That's it.
The only thing,
I don't think that inscription has anything at all.
The only
I don't think so either.
The only thing similar was this new murder in Whitechapel that I had read that said on the trial or something, there was only one Jewish man in the jury, which is curious if we consider the significant number of Hebrews in the Whitechapel population.
How are we on trains?
The train is late.
I almost think there's a typo in one of the numbers, which would be horrifying.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so it says here that there's a 105E for a place called Shadwell Station. The highest number is 95, but one of the first four words is Shadwell Station, which is a little, but I don't know that.
Well, let's try it out.
All right.
Should be able to tell pretty quickly if we're at a train station or not.
Yep. Tired of walking the streets of Whitechapel, we take the train and leave from Shadwell Station. This certainly sounds like it's a train station.
I was getting tired.
Yeah. We then head towards the docks of the new basin.
Oh, now wait, I'm suspicious. It's 95?
Yeah.
What is... 95 is New Basin.
Oh, okay, so that's something else.
Oh. Okay.
What is New Basin?
Shadwell, New Basin. Yeah, I don't have a clue what that is. Let's go there!
Maybe there's a clue.
Let's say, yeah, that's
a little
yeah.
A train station over here.
Oh!
What's it called?
South Bromley.
Was it numbered?
103.
Oh, that's not going to exist.
There's a 101.
Yeah, I'm not willing to do it if it wasn't actually the train station mistakenly numbered. because we had no reason to. Shadwell Basin is or was part of the London Docks, a group of docks built by the London Dock Company.
Good.
There was stuff about a sailor.
Yeah.
We learned, I was deliberately looking into information about the shipping yard. I was looking at that specifically in the,
You want me to read it?
Yeah, I do, because I want to go to the docks in order to find out more about sailors. All right.
I'm looking for a place where sailors hang out.
I'm looking for the man that killed my father.
I will tell you, this is almost a two-page entry, so it's almost certainly either something or it's another psychic.
Would you rather start at London Docks to see if it leads?
Yes, let's do that.
94, right before it.
Oh, there is no 94.
Oh, okay.
Well, if we're in the neighborhood anyway, let's walk across the street to the New Basin.
We then head towards the docks of the New Basin, recently set up to hold the more modern ships. In front of the main building of the castle line, despite the flurries of icy winds blowing from the Thames, an impressive number of workers are listening to the offers made by a small group of employees of the docks company standing on piled-up crates so that everyone can see and hear them. The atmosphere is tense and the debate lively, a hubbub of malcontent puncturing each intervention by the members of the company. Sixpence an hour, that's inconceivable, gentlemen, shouts a member of the company perched on a barrel. That extra penny, for which you're blocking the docks and making impossible any loading or unloading, would keep the shareholders from any dividends. The shareholders despise us, exclaims a member of the docks committee, encouraged by his colleagues. Just like the press and the ruling classes. Our protests are termed workers' walks, and we're treated like drunkards and uncultured ruffians. And yet the work? We're the ones doing it, and for a salary which doesn't even allow us to feed our families. My wife is forced to work all day so that our kids have enough to eat. A general acclamation rises from the crowd. People are shouting. The rare few women present are howling. One of them... One of them claims...
That's just what women sound like, right? Right?
I don't know. I'm not a doctor.
Oh. One of them claims that they're showing solidarity and that they've had enough of being exploited in factories and treated as though they're hysterical as soon as they make the smallest complaint. And another...
Sorry, we've made so much progress.
Another, a baby bundled in her arms, shouts her despair at giving birth to the hungry dying.
Like right there on the docks.
God.
Just splatting out a baby.
You found one of my entries, I see.
Yes, yes I did.
She certainly. Just gives birth to a skeleton who's immediately like,
workers who have come...
Give me biscuits.
That's
what they call food in England.
Workers who have come from sugar refineries and smelters of Whitechapel noisily manifest their support to the dock workers and call the members of the docks company turncoats at the heel of a dictator of the director. We're on the verge of a riot. One of the members of the company, very worried by the way things are going, attempts to bring back calm to answer. We understand your demands, but believe me, that extra penny isn't possible. The boat owners are already demanding to load and unload their goods themselves. And the owners have the sympathy of the inhabitants of London who are impatiently waiting for their goods. The docks company is practically unprofitable at the current time. The ships from the two largest companies, for which the majority among you used to work for, have already temporarily transferred their trade to Southampton. If the strike continues any longer, this transfer will become permanent. Better half a loaf than no bread at all. This last declaration breaks the strikers' morale, and the crowd begins to discuss the speech in a hubbub of chaotic discontent. The members of the committee, who are the most agitated, attempt a new intervention, arguing that the problem will reach Southampton without any great conviction. We take advantage of this moment of hesitancy to walk through the disorganized crowd and attempt to find a dock worker who might have worked with a man named Seaman.
Luckily, oh, yeah.
That's
okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Luckily, a sailor
literally named Seaman.
Yes. Luckily, a stocky dock worker with a repulsive smell due to how pickled he's been in his own sweat knows him.
I know him a bit, that John Seaman, or Gibbs as we call him sometimes, explains the dock worker to us as he adjusts his askew cap. We work together as longshoremen at the Queen's Pipe.
The Queen's Pipe?
You see the tall chimney spitting out a thick black smoke over there? That's where all the goods unfit for human consumption and counterfeits are burned, and there's plenty. Why, only yesterday I had to incinerate 900 Australian mutton legs that had been left to rot in a warehouse.
Ugh.
What a waste. Most were still good. I even took advantage to improve my breakfast.
So Gibbs, insists Wiggins.
He worked in the area till last year. Then the bastard had trouble with the police. I must admit that he's not the kind of man to be satisfied with a bundle of burning wood, a mug of warm tea, and the touch of a woman. He even came by to say hello at the end of last August and took the time to help out and pick up two or three of his things he'd left. He'd found work as a sailor for a few weeks at sea, for the Jardine, I think. Would you happen to know where we could find him now? Asked Wiggins. When we chatted, he told me he'd been roaming around Carter Street and that we had to go out for a pint when he got back to the Anchor. Is the git in trouble again? That's it.
Was it Porky that put us on this guy's trail?
Yes,
I think it was.
And that building might explain some of the discrepancies about our suspect's appearance.
Go on.
Well, one of the murders reported a significantly darker-skinned individual.
Mm-hmm. So, that's true.
And yet we've confirmed that these are all most likely the same person.
Mm-hmm.
So perhaps you worked in a building full of burning soot.
Oh, okay.
Knew about a building full of burning soot. And knew that was a place you could get rid of things.
Sure.
He went out for 2 weeks. How's that timeline on our murders?
That actually would work pretty well. So he came by the end of August and picked up some things he left. He had found work for a few weeks at sea for the Jardine, I think.
That was what got me thinking of looking for a sailor to begin with, that he was absent for all of October.
Yes. Yeah.
Hmm.
Well, we have a name for him, Gibbs. We also know the Anchor.
Or we could check with the Jardine office and see if they have a line on where his checks get sent.
Indeed. Well, it is definitely someone else's turn to read after that epic tale.
I was ready for it to be another non-starter.
Yeah.
The way it was going so long, I'm like, oh, they're punishing us for just picking a random fucking thing. And then they start talking about semen. I'm like, oh, wait, that guy.
No, I was deliberate. I was not cheating.
I remember there was.
I did not hit her.
Wanted to go to the docks.
I do remember that. I don't remember how we would have ever gotten to that specific dock out of the 20 or so.
I used my psychic powers.
Well, you know, sometimes investigators just catch a lucky break.
Well, I think that if we tried to go to all of the other docks, it wouldn't have worked.
We went to London docks, and then there was a riot.
It would have taken a long time. England's on an island.
Mm-hmm.
We'd have had to have gone all the way around.
Oh, man, can you imagine if we started, like, one to the left, and we just...
They call it the... Lefties over there.
The Thames.
Thames and right. Thames and starboard.
Okay.
The Jardine Company confirms that John Gibbs worked on one of its ships from September 5th to October 10th this year, who unfortunately didn't renew his contract due to incompatibility with the crew. Would you happen to have an address you could give us? Yes, try 44 Carter Street E.
Well,
may I?
30th?
Yeah.
Wait.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, she was killed on the
September
30th. But
it said 10th through... Wait, did it?
When was he out?
September 5th to October 10th.
I think that puts
but,
it...
But, well...
That seems to be outside of range of two.
However, maybe he's still Jack the Ripper but didn't kill her.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe. Because this
we don't know for a fact. This one has a couple of oddities to it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But could he have even committed the second one of the ones we investigated? What was the newspaper for the second one is September 10th.
Well, I've got it written down right here.
September 8th is when she was found. So now, yes. And when did he leave?
September 5th.
Yeah, he would have to be innocent of the second.
I'm going to his office anyway!
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So we don't think that he's Jack the Ripper, but maybe he's still... I don't know. I don't know, but where else are we going
to
go?
But sometimes you have to follow a...
What else are we going to do?
Well,
he's gonna try and like take us off his trail by giving us a real lead.
Maybe.
That's how that
works. That's how it works on TV.
We enter Carter Street. Yeah, we gotta resolve the B plot, folks. Yeah. Whatever that is. We enter Carter Street. This alleyway is littered with cabbage cores and newspapers, and from perpendicular alleys come the repulsive scent of decaying cabbages. We walk by a cabbage shop.
What?
Low storefront cabbages jut forward under an awning that completely covers the cabbages. We ask the shopkeeper if he knows Seaman. Yeah, I know one. Rebecca shacked in a loft with her brother, a guy not prone to talking, but it's been a while since I've seen her. At the heart of this small maze of lofted buildings, abandoned and blackened by the polluted cabbages of East London, we spot a passage with a rusted plaque. We step over a crate filled with broken bottles next to a bin of rotting rubbish. Rubbish. To step deeper into a gloomy and cracked passage, at the end of which is a steep and muddy stairwell buried in dark. We've gone through like three dungeons now. We go up to the last floor, guarded by an iron handrail. and end up going up a ladder leading to a trapdoor with a lock. Wiggins knocks without getting any answer. A thin little girl then opens the door located on the landing and looks at us from the door jamb. We smile in order not to scare her and ask, "Are your neighbors not home?" I assume there's just like seven of us all on the ladder.
We all smile in unison,
oh,
a small child.
John, I haven't seen him in at least a week. Good thing, he scares me. Rebecca, she was nice. She even sewn my clothes back up. She left for San Francisco over 2 months ago because her mommy's very sick. She was the one that told you that? No, my mommy said that. She also has the gutter rabbit. Gutter rabbit? Yeah, you know, cats. An authoritative woman's voice coming from the little girl's apartment cuts the conversation short. Sarah! What are you doing? The little girl softly closes the door. Wiggins points out the rusty lock on the trap door to Luke, our locksmith.
Oh.
The crude mechanism doesn't hold for long. Against our expert skeleton key, and we stealthily enter the loft. We enter on tiptoes into a small burnished room arranged under the roof with with a bare floor plunged into darkness. A cold stove occupies the space in the middle of this first room. We inspect the stove and find it filled with ashes and bits of coal. A rickety table, three unmatched chairs, a mat, a crate filled with wrinkled potatoes, a bed, two cabbages, an armoire, and a set of shelves furnish this outmoded apartment. But it is well kept in comparison with the other slums we've visited in our neighborhood lately. On the crate are piled a few rags, bits of cloth, and a butcher's cabbage. The shelves contain dishes, a bottle of milk, a few toiletry accessories, and three bottles containing gin, vodka, and whiskey. Above our heads, once our eyes become used to the darkness of the loft, we discover hanging from the belt's roofs a clothesline from which are hanging cat pelts, looking like sleeping bats. Wiggins crosses the lofted room, bent over to avoid knocking his head against the lowest beams, heads to the back of the loft, separated from the entrance by a washed-out wool curtain which, suspended by two hooks, divides the loft in two. Behind it, we discover a mattress placed on the ground with covers full of holes pushed under an angle of the roof and an armoire whose legs have been sewn off so it could fit between the bed and a heavy horizontal beam. Inside the armoire, we find 100 gold, a potion, women's clothes, a few dresses, chemises, skirts, and long woolen socks. On the other side of the bed, pushed under an angle with a lofted ceiling, we discover a mat covered with popular illustrated newspapers, some of which are pornographic. On the first pile, young virgins captured by lecherous Turkish pirates discover pleasure raped in harems. During our inspection of the apartment, a crushing atmosphere... Well, there's a picture I wanted to...
Oh, you wanted to fully take
yeah, it. Yeah. Presses on our shoulders, and we twitch with each rat skitter behind the worm-eaten walls. We head back out into the street in a tomb-like silence.
Whoa.
They split town!
What?
This is the guy described as the knife, is that right? What's Porky's address?
Porky is 52 EC.
52 EC. No, he describes the knife. The knife is his alias for Jack the Ripper. Heard tell of a really strange sword. A dock worker from Whitechapel named Seaman. He would have done something very, very sketchy, if you know what I mean, on the last weekend of August. And that's when the murders began. Strange, isn't it? So maybe there's something else, but, yeah. Not our man.
No.
And not present to give any accounting for him.
Oof.
Well,
we're no closer than we started.
I feel a little bit closer, even though I'm not really.
Well, I guess we've eliminated some possibilities.
Yes.
Such as
the psychic and
damn cabbages.
The cat skinner.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yep. I still wonder if there's not some way to follow up on what the graphologists spoke to us about.
Well, I seem to confirm that one of the letters was concocted by multiple people and was full of good faith, but the other one was a mystery and was full of misspellings. Right, kidney.
Yeah.
K-I-D-N-I.
But he thought that included intentional misspellings or something, right?
That?
Right.
Like the handwriting was more refined.
Artificial mischange later or something like that. Can you say that?
Yeah, changed deliberately, I thought.
Changed deliberately.
Or misspelled deliberately. deliberately.
Yeah, misspelled deliberately. Maybe not like after the fact.
But right.
Like, writing on the front of the card, the address resembles the one in the letter from the 25th. It's the original, which is one with a kidney. That's the one sent to Mr. Lusk. And the second one is sent to the Central News Office, London City, EC, October 1st. Yeah. London EC stamp, which isn't the one used by the Whitechapel or the Spitalfields neighborhoods. Thinks it's a fake in bad taste. But, okay, so something else that we remarked upon is that it uses the phrase Jack the Ripper, which wasn't a name given to the press yet, which is yet another nod in the direction of maybe someone directly connected to the case.
What's the origin of the name Jack the Ripper? Did he call himself that? I thought that was what the public called him. Like, because he was ripping people apart.
I thought that it was a bullpen name. Like, what the...
Oh, what the police used.
Yeah.
So Jack the Ripper wouldn't even know he was called Jack the Ripper.
Right.
Right. Unless he's has an in with the police somehow.
Right.
Back to conspiracy theory number 3.
Is Jack the Ripper? Oh, we already looked. He's not in the phone book.
It's true. Well, we did look. Yeah. Oh, excuse me.
Sorry. I'm just reviewing. Is that book one over there?
Yes.
What you looking for, Herbie?
I'm just checking the answers, seeing if there was anything.
So we tried contacting any of the other Jack Bros. From, you know, that great virtual spin-off.
Yeah.
A virtual boy spin-off.
No.
What's the envelope for this one?
It's a virtual boy game. No one played it.
I played Waterworld.
Oh no, I'm terrible. Sorry.
Where's the envelope for... Oh, there it is.
Answer.
The only thing that I feel like I got for sure from reading those is that he did wear a red scarf.
Yeah.
Grumbles.
Was he left or right-handed?
Oh.
He's right-handed.
Right-handed, I thought, if that's the first one.
Yes.
Yeah, the first one.
Yeah.
What was the position?
Right-handed, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, well, without, like, a deliberate, like, direction to march in, I think we should just continue trying to find leads, basically just by conjecture as to possibilities at this point.
Is there another psychic?
I don't know. Brandon, where should we go next? We've got multiple conspiracies. Pick one to follow up on. Maybe we'll find another joke answer.
Yes. Where's the rule book?
The rule book is at Herbie's feet.
There are rules?
Not many.
Sort of.
Yeah, are there any experts that we haven't hit? Have we not talked to Langsdale Pike yet?
Who's that?
He's my favorite.
He's the society's colonist.
Yeah.
Probably not terribly useful.
But he's always good for a laugh.
Might be the only one back there we didn't check yet.
Yeah, I assume we've done... Yeah, we did criminology, trying to find some stuff. Definitely did that.
Spoke to Lomax.
Yep.
What about Hymax?
I can't find him. Maybe he's Jack the Ripper.
That's a suspect.
I don't know if, you know, like, rumors don't seem, well, possible.
Yeah, he's also usually, like, a high society guy, so he's even less likely.
Well, how could we investigate the idea of a policeman on the inside or whatever?
We could go on a balloon ride.
Yes. If you don't tie well.
We could enlist the services of famous hypnotist Milo DeMeyer.
Also, yes.
He's trapped in the past.
Fantastic experiments in new mesmerism.
I wonder if they have one of those bullshit things in every single one of these.
They've got a lot of red herrings.
A lot of red herrings, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's a dead end that's an absurdly obvious dead end. Like, what would us being hypnotized do?
Nothing that I can imagine.
Imagine you're Jack the Ripper.
No.
The psychic did it.
I'm pretty sure the psychic did it.
Okay, other things that we know about but haven't, like, developed. The papers always go on and on about Sir Charles Warren, who I think at this point has stepped down.
Yeah, there was a long rant about him, I think, in this one.
But, like, within the context of, like, the timeline of today has stepped down. So there's, like, people that are even above Lestrade, who we haven't ever really, like, spoken to or anything like that. We've never really had a reason to, but...
Can I see the...
The what? There's lots. Where's the most recent newspaper?
Oh, this one.
Thank you. There is also the other weird murder mystery where someone's arm got ripped off.
Yeah, the dismembering.
That we've not followed up on because it's in a completely different part of town.
Yes.
Try going back to any of the old scenes.
All of the old scenes are the places that recap those murders.
Okay.
Yeah.
One of the things that showed up at the London Hospital for the letter sent was that he was going to do something again nearby.
Yeah.
And so there's a park right next door.
Okay.
And I've been staring at that for a while.
Let's go look at the park.
Okey-dokey.
Do it.
What's the number?
If 132. Oh, am I reading it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't
know. Yeah, it's your
turn. EC or E?
EC.
E.
Oh, E. Sorry.
It won't exist, I don't
think.
Oh,
there's nothing above 100.
There's nothing above 95, even.
Okay, well, in that case, we're not going to get the park. And nothing nearby this guy is going to exist.
What about 7?
7 it is!
What about 1?
We can start at 1.
I mean, we could. I think another murder is bound to happen by the time we find clues that way.
We figured out why the window was broken, right?
It's been broken for a long time.
It has been broken for a long time.
Yeah, that was how they got in.
Okay, so that's another thing, is the state of the apartment. The organs, we think, might have been rearranged by the time the autopsy was taken.
Yes.
Additionally, there was apparently a very hot fire in there.
Although
it didn't happen until after 4 in the morning, because multiple people said that they didn't see a light coming from that apartment in the hours previous.
I still wonder what they burned that did that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can we call, like, the CSI people from TV?
We are the CSI people.
No! Do we just say enhance?
I don't want to say it outright because it's from the police, but the police did... I mean, Aberlane, who is not quite as incompetent as the others, did give
not
us 2
all.
Leads that we never poked at.
Oh, please. Oh, God.
Aaron Kosminski, a Polish-Jewish hairdresser who has apparently lost his sanity and lives in Whitechapel, and also a journalist...
We followed up on him.
Did we?
Okay. By accident.
Not this mystery, I don't think.
No.
Yeah, I don't think so.
And then one journalist from the Daily News even suggested that the murderer uses the sewers to go around Whitechapel.
Yeah, the sewers.
I feel like Holmes said that was
preposterous. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's worth thinking about at least.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the other one's like more concrete.
Yeah, the insane dude. Let's go with the insane dude.
Wait, what is his name? Excuse me.
Aaron Kosminski.
Okay. Do you want to look up?
Oh.
An insane man.
Yeah.
nothing else, it might be bonusy material.
There's a... How do you spell Kosminski?
K-O-S.
K-O-S?
Yeah.
Or some say Kosum.
Kosinski or Kosinski?
Do we think the...
Sanitarium, maybe?
Yeah.
Might be.
Let's look at hospitals.
Is there a sewer headquarters?
Yeah, the sewer headquarters. Maybe let's review that information again.
Oh,
Averlin was at 100 DC.
Yeah, 100 DC. It's at the end of it.
Certainly. 100 EC. Chat about the Mary Jane Kelly case. Exchange at the entrance of the Miller's Court apartment. They arrived about the same time as Superintendent Arnold and Dr. Phillips.
Have we ever spoken to Arnold?
Arnold?
I think Arnold is like one of those guys, like Charles Warren, that's like in the system.
We were actually never able to find him.
Did we ever find Walter Dew? We talked to him.
No, we did. We did.
Yeah, we did.
It was one of our earliest leads, but we never did find Arnold himself.
And Dr. Phillips, I assume we talked to.
Dr. Phillips.
Is he at one of the hospitals?
Maybe. Give me a number for him that might help.
2EC?
2EC. Huh. I don't see a 2EC.
Oh, that's the recap.
That's 2E.
Oh, that's 2E, you're right.
Yeah, 2E, we did go there.
Maybe we should speak to Dr. Phillips.
2EC?
And try it out. See if there's something there.
Like he did say he was a doctor.
That's true. That's true.
And Dr. Phillips has always been Dr. Bad Advice.
Maybe this guy knows where the 2EC. Sewer headquarters is.
Ooh.
2EC. Yeah.
Nope. Okay.
Yeah, I think we might have talked to him at a proper location, though.
I think we did. I remember you talking about the doctor who's bad at things, and then...
Yep, that was him. On October 1st in Cuttack Osara, India, the wife of Colonel Henry Brimbleriddle of the 11th Regiment Ministry of Social Affairs gave birth to a son. I read that.
A baby Brimbleriddle.
I read that almost entirely because of the name Brimbleriddle.
This is a very serious game.
Once he arrived, the superintendent decided to warn Sir Charles Warren, and make sure that the door remained intact. Oh, because he went to try and get the dogs.
Oh, yeah.
But we didn't know at that point that he had just resigned.
Right, yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure where we would investigate, like, the sewers. Anyway, what was the information that we were looking for on Kosinski?
Aaron Kosminski.
Uh-huh.
Polish-Jewish hairdresser. Name. Seems he's lost his sanity and currently lives in Whitechapel.
What's the sentence after?
I'd be grateful to you if you obtained any information about
okay.
him. This is just a theory. We have few witnesses.
Got it. Okay, so let's. Yeah. I mean, you can still be. I mean, I think in
yeah.
particular, London is the place to be if you're going to be an insane hairdresser.
Is there a meat pie shop?
Markets, music halls, newspapers, parks, pawnbrokers, police stations, post offices, printers, prisons, public houses, restaurants, Scotland Yard, settlement houses, shoemakers, solicitors, Somerset House. Why did I want... Someone was receiving welfare that we couldn't...
Yeah. That was when we were trying to find...
That was George Hutchinson. We did find him. We did find him. The newspaper tag.
Right. Stables, stationers, stations, steamship companies, synagogues, tailors... Wait, was he Jewish?
Polish Jew, yeah.
19E, maybe. Oh, wait, that's a Spanish synagogue. That's kind of... Well...
I mean, synagogue is...
Yes? Yes? What do you have to say?
Would they speak Hebrew there? Like, is...
I don't know.
Let's wander into a random...
Well, there's two synagogues, so we could check them both if we really felt like it. Mm-hmm. The closest one is 19E.
Does it speak the correct language? Because that might actually be the better choice.
I know.
Newspaper.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm just trying to scan for...
I can't believe there's not, like, barbers.
There's no 19. Either.
What about a 21SW?
What was it,
21? 21SW.
Mm, no.
Nuts! Nuts! I can't believe it's so hard to find this guy. Kozinski.
I guess there's a reason they asked us to try and look into it, because he's apparently a hard man to find.
It seems like it shouldn't be, though. Like, he knows multiple pieces of information about him. A, where he's from. B, what his occupation is. C, that he has lost his mind. Now, last of all, here's a whole list of hospitals. Which one of them do we think is going to be, like, a sanitarium or something like that? There's literally, like, 10 of them.
Move down the list. Well, they won't exist.
We went to this place already, and we didn't hear any new information about it.
Right. Like, that was where the letter is.
Right. There's the synagogue that we just tried to see about.
Yeah, I wanted to go to that one earlier, just because it's close to the crime that was in red.
We should go everywhere that's close to the crime. We should go to all of these places.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
And they say that he resides in Whitechapel.
Right. Which is what sort of baffles me about the fact that he's not in the book. Oh! Damn it.
What were you?
I was looking for the embassies. But he's, I don't know. I'm losing my mind.
Where are you going to go?
Where am I going? Oh, yeah, that's a great question. Follow me! Let's look under S for sanitarium. Unless, is there something in the newspaper that's like, are you crazy? Come stay with us.
I mean, look for halfway houses.
There's a lot of those. I mean, there's plenty of decrepit places where you can get a bed. Is that this recent book?
Yeah.
Can I see it when you're done?
Yeah, I'm actually going through all of the old entries from this one, so I would be a while being done. Go ahead and
looky thingy. I just want to look at a thing real quick.
Nag's head.
Oh, do we ever find Mr. Arnold?
I don't think so. Did you find out?
Do you mean Superintendent Arnold? We could try 53EC.
That sounds familiar.
Actually, I just gave the book back to Herbie. I don't know why I'm looking at you.
What are you looking at?
53EC.
53EC. 53?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. No, that's a Benson. Excuse me.
Oh.
No, it is. It's a Benson Arnold. I'm sorry. I'm going completely out of my mind.
How many Arnolds are there?
Just the one. God, I'm on the verge of like Googling that hairdresser's name and trying to figure out why I can't just look him up. Like, it seems like it shouldn't be that difficult.
I thought we'd heard about him before.
Like, from some other entry?
Yeah. Like, it's, like that really did sound familiar, and I thought we ran down on that.
Maybe in the big list of folks that Disraeli gave us?
Maybe.
Can I see the book again when you're done?
Sure, let me look up one more.
I might be crossing him with Weirdo Cult Guy.
Wait,
another crazy person?
There is something important. We have a thing with Disraeli O'Brien where we can look up a name if we have it from another source.
Oh, yeah. Maybe we've run into some new names.
That's why that might have been why I heard the name.
Right. Okay.
Looks like we looked at 97 and 132 there before. I'll review those real quick and see. 32 was Aaron Kosmiski was interned at the Bethlehem Insane Asylum.
That's what it was. We did look up this guy.
Yeah.
Kind of dead-ended real quick.
Well, actually, we didn't bother to look up the Bethlehem. I mean, maybe he knows how to find the sewers.
Well, we found his name from a new source, so can we...
28SE.
28SE? The Bethlehem Insane Asylum is actually in London?
Yeah. That's just the name of the place. They didn't ship him to Israel.
No, that's a new entry, so someone should read it.
What's the number again?
Did you think that that's what they meant, is that they sent him to Israel?
Yeah.
Well, Israel didn't exist back in 1888.
No, that's true.
So.
I guess it didn't.
Yeah.
Bethlehem existed.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if you'd want to send him there.
I think it was... Was it part of the Ottoman Empire back then?
Probably.
Anyway, the thing.
Yeah, what's the number?
Oh, excuse me. I can't read.
28-something.
28SE. We're going to the insane asylum.
We yeah! Found.
We're
going
to live there now.
Sweet.
This is our new home.
For checking me in. Give my regards to Watson.
28SE.
Yes.
Oh, thank goodness there's one. I get to read a thing. I took care of Aaron Kosminski personally, Dr. Hochin, an experienced alienist with a pointed beard, informs us. He's a Jew who immigrated here in 1882 to flee from the pogroms in Russia. He worked as a barber in the neighborhood of Whitechapel. He went from a simple eccentricity to the blackest madness. He now alternates between bouts of auditory hallucinations and periods of apathy. During a moment of lucidity, he explained to me that during his hallucinations, his movements are controlled by an instinct which informs his mind. His hallucinations force him to refuse to wash himself and accept food from other people. That's why he eats off the very ground by picking up garbage. He can become quite violent, especially when under the influence of alcohol. It's during one of those aggressive fits that we admitted him here. During his periods of apathy, he partakes in solitary vices. Then he goes through phases of delirium, during which he becomes quite loud and spits out anti-Semitic insults, which are no doubt used against him in the past. I'm afraid that his state has deteriorated irredeemably.
This is definitely a Brandon entry.
Yes.
Would you happen to know where he resides? No, I don't have the faintest clue, but the poor man is easy to recognize from afar due to his face having been severely marked by smallpox.
No one's mentioned smallpox, and we have had a couple of people get a look at his face now.
I thought that he was going to say, by his recognizable red scarf.
I was thinking that.
And the knife that he carries in his hands at all times.
And the bayonet that
yeah.
he was...
Are you looking at Disraeli's entry?
Oh, no, I can do that, though.
Yeah.
14WC?
Or wherever he can be found.
14WC, so there's a large number of entries, and then you can also look up more details about ones that you have a name for.
Yeah, so are there any new names that we've run across that we didn't have when we first met up with Disraeli?
Let's see, there's Larry Gulliver, Frank Seaman, which I think we have run aground, Burke and Mansell. They're thieves.
Weren't Burke and Mansell to do with the stamps?
Maybe.
Stamps.
We never actually talked to either of them, I don't think, though. But we
what was the entry for Birkenance, I'll say?
Well, we have to have their name from something else is the problem. I don't think we ever found
that. Well, that's what I'm specifically asking.
Oh.
Does anyone remember hearing about Burke and Mansell?
Other than this.
Okay.
Thomas Sadler, no. Preden Zarello, no. Charles Hill, Rebecca Priestley and John Kane, and then Aaron Kunsminski.
Hmm. Hmm. All right, Rachel, where are we going?
I tried to go to a park. I just wanted to chill out there for a bit and see some birds. That didn't work. Next up, if not the park. Ooh. Is there anything else we can get from, like, going back to old places and looking for leads that we've run up on? So, like, the frying pan, I remember being a huge entry that was central to a lot of stuff, and we ran down a couple of leads very hard, but I don't know if there's some that we ignored.
I just looked at it. I didn't see anything new, but we could certainly look at it again.
Okay, which one?
The frying pan, 17E. The thing is, like, everyone's getting picked up from around there, but it was weird that they were getting picked up around there, not from the nearer restaurant. So the other thought I had is if we went to the nearer restaurant.
The Queen's Head?
We've tried to go there before, haven't we?
Oh, sorry. You can scan 17E there if you want. Yeah. Reviewed all the old entries, but didn't see anything.
actually, Herbie, can you do me a favor after I read through this?
Yeah.
Can you write down the names that we're trying to find for Disraeli so that if we hear one of them again, we can be like, aha!
Yeah, I'll write them down after if you finish.
Black Mary. There's Black Mary and Dark other one. Like, the nicknames for, yeah, Dark Anne?
Wasn't it?
Something like that, yeah. The two who were murdered up here had those nicknames, but none of the other ones had nicknames like that. We found George Hutchinson. We found Joseph Barnett, right?
Yep.
And Maria.
Yep.
Yeah, she was a laundromat.
Yep.
She was the one we thought was the last boss of the first half, but it turned out to be wrong.
Someone says something about a nonsensical boss type thing. I keep thinking about that picture from the Eurovision concert of the lady who had the really really, really elaborate like robe with like set up like a harness and everything, and they had like the voice of Croatia or something with like a Dark Souls but the background itself was like blue and had like little sparkles everywhere. It kind of looked like it could be from like a what's that place called? The Moon City. Snowy, icy.
Earth.
Yeah, it looked like it could be a boss from, like some DLC boss from there.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Alright, I was gonna.
Well, no, we need to pick somewhere to go.
Oh.
Yeah, I was gonna say write down the names that Degrassi.
I mean, I can write them down, but honestly, remembering and looking at them, they all seem kind of nonsense, other than maybe the robbery guys. I don't know.
They're free lookups if we hear their name again.
Well, here, I mean, just put a
sticker there. Yeah, it's easier than writing down a bunch of them. 14 WC. Let me see. I can never find anything in here.
So what did you do before you met up with Sherlock and kind of got?
We were trying to get a read on
the last person was to be with the
victims. Yeah, because we were trying to figure out what time it was.
And we thought we did it and we were wrong.
So we spoke, I still have no idea what the leap was that you're supposed to get to meet up with Antonio.
I never was able to figure that out either.
Yeah, because we spoke to someone that knew her, and apparently she has a roommate who is this Maria that we found at the laundromat, which took quite a bit of doing. We found her old boyfriend, and we found her new boyfriend. And apparently neither of those guys were the last person to have seen her that night, because she was with some other third man. As part of her job. Yeah, this Antony guy.
Yeah. And then after that was Jack the Ripper.
Yeah. So
follow at least 4 leads.
She went north after that last thing. Like, she talked to the guy here, and then they separated and she went north. What's up north that she would have headed towards to try and find someone? Because she would have met him somewhere even near where...
I thought she was running because she saw a cop.
Maybe.
Can I see the book?
Yeah.
Oop.
I don't think she ran, but I think she was like...
Yeah, she peaced out, I thought.
Yeah.
Two northwest is this entry. Let's review this. So this is the one that we didn't even find out about until we went and met with Sherlock. And this says, in English,
Bonjour.
After having asked a few questions, received some descriptions, we're directed to a certain Antony Preacha. A man wears an astrakhan coat and a distinctive club tie pin.
Oh, the club pin. Sorry. That was the clue.
Is that how we...
Oh, that's how we were supposed to find
him. Supposed to have found him?
That was the guy we thought was the suspect.
Oh, okay. He's a man in his 30s with long dark hair and a mustache. He doesn't avoid our questions. That's right, I was with Kelly between 2 and 4 in the morning. We walked down Dorset Street, but she didn't want to seem to stop there. She wanted to earn a bit more money. I told her that at that time she wouldn't find that many more people. People are in bed or they've already gone to work. At the corner of Commercial Street and Dorset... Yep, okay. A policeman came towards us from the south, and Kelly scampered off before he reached us. The policeman asked me for a light, and we chatted for a few minutes while I saw Kelly go away to the north toward the market. It was way past 4 at that point.
Let's go to the market.
Sure.
Is that 8? Have we been to 8?
I feel
so.
What is it called?
Spillfields Market.
I feel like we tried it and balanced, but...
Yeah. Yeah, there's literally 2 sentences there.
Yeah.
What are they?
It's busy. Everyone is talking about the murder. No one has any information.
Oh, what if we kept going? No.
Yeah.
I feel like we did that too, but...
I feel like we've talked to... I assume we talked to the police at their main location there.
Yes.
That's where Aberline is.
Yeah, Aberline's house, so there's no way to find out who the officer was who bumped into her. Or almost bumped into her.
Not directly, anyway.
What's between a train station and where she was going to the north?
Everything.
There's this stuff here.
On the way to the train station, she would have passed by 97, but that's kind of a leap.
If she was going to the train station, sure.
Well, if he was coming from the train station, because he's...
I thought she was going the other way, so he came this way.
Yeah, the cop came this way.
Right.
She bolts to the north, and I might have cut through the market or not, I don't know.
Well, but she went here, so I feel like she was looking in this area for
a... Oh, do you know she actually made it over there?
That's where she was murdered. She's murdered there, I'm sorry.
So she took Jack the Ripper home with her.
Right.
So she found the guy somewhere, and I'm trying to think of where she found the guy and at what time. So she would have found him at about 4, probably coming from the trains or from the police station. Which kind of puts, like, 97 is between where she is and the trains, and that's kind of like...
Well, yeah. Did we check that?
No.
Okay.
What are we checking? Sorry, here you go.
97 EC, maybe.
We've done it. 97 EC is a Disraeli O'Brien entry.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
Alright.
That's weird that it would be an existing number.
That means they knew that they had that spot to burn, because there's no relevant clue there.
Wow! Never mind!
Have we been to the Queen's Head?
No.
Let's.
I think we bounced, but.
Was it? What is it?
55E.
55. I'll look real quick if there's something to read, though. It belongs to a Lobos. 55E?
I think it belongs to Rachel. We keep taking the book away from her.
Sorry. There is no 55E, but.
There is no 55E? Okay. Well, in that case.
What about, one of these 53 or 49?
Yeah, I feel like we did this, but I don't mind reading them again.
Oh.
53 and
49E. Don't see them.
Oh, well.
You probably
didn't. There's a 53E, but it's one sentence.
What is it?
We confirm with the company's registry that Frank Seaman got on a ship to New York on Monday, November 5th.
Which we already knew, so I'm going to kill that.
And then...
He slipped through our grasp.
So for 53 and 49, 49 does not exist.
Okay.
So there's no witnesses along that route was kind of what I was lurching towards.
And Miller's
Where
Court?
Did 3 tend to pick up her jump? Was it also at the front?
Miller's Court is the source of the crime. Sorry, what?
Okay.
Number 3, did she pick up her jump?
Scene
crime?
Of the crime, not source of the crime. She... I don't remember... I think she frequented the frying pan. I don't know if that's where she met this particular John.
List.
All right, well, we got to go somewhere.
I can't even think of a placeless long shot is the problem. I can't.
I still don't feel like I've established it clear enough. What pattern? What is
it? You can check all the places
so
nearby. Change. I don't know.
We did, I think.
I
don't think we actually did talk to Pike if we want to.
I don't know that we've spoken to Henry Ellis either.
What's the one of them?
Journalist at the London Times, 30 EC.
30 EC?
Yep.
Okay. We'll write it down if it is worth writing down.
30 EC. Oh. Henry Ellis lets us into his office, apparently happy to see us. This story is incredible. I just came back from Paris 2 days ago, and this is making the news over there. A suspect was even arrested and released in France, in Boulogne, some time ago. This new crime is terrible, according to what I've learned, and is more horrible than all previous ones, as if the killer was building to a crescendo in the mutilations he's inflicting upon his victims. I've also got my hands on an article from last year, which should remind you of another case, which should be undoubtedly fresh in your minds. And it's from the Essex Times, July 21st, 1887, The Mystery of Raynham. The human remains which were found in the Thames, first at the Waterloo Jetty in the village of Raynham, then at the height of Victoria Quay and the jetty of Battersea Park in London, and finally in the Regent's Canal in Kentish Town, have all been exhumed and are now in the possession of the police. The remains are comprised of the arms and lower end of the torso, the waist and the legs, meaning the entire body, other than the upper torso and the head. The cloth bags used to wrap the remains were all identical, and it leaves no doubt that the victim was a single woman who nonetheless has yet to be identified. While there's little chance that one who dismembered the corpses has any knowledge of anatomy, the autopsy reveals that there was no evidence leading to the belief that the body was stolen from a hospital and that this is a macabre prank pulled by a student from the medical faculty of London. The order of the successive discoveries of the parcels leads the investigators to believe that the murderer threw the bags into the river as he drew near to London. The police asks the population to advise him of any recent disappearances of women aged roughly 25 and who has never born children. The music stopped right then for a moment, too, and that's, I don't think, at all relevant.
Mm.
The MO is so phenomenally different. Darn.
Could we check Pike?
Yes.
It's a Lobos one.
2 SW.
2 SWA.
SWA. At the social club, Langdale Pike is busy reading an article from the National Review, criticizing the attitude of the press in regards to the recent crimes in Whitechapel. We join his audience to listen to his lecture, which has to do with our investigation. The actions of the daily press are greatly deplored by many of those who know the poorer classes and attempt to bring them aid. We can already see their effects. Attempts to usurp the misdeeds of the famous criminal, widespread vice among the popular layers of society. Just because a certain number of workers from the lower classes are delinquents, that doesn't mean we must contaminate the minds of the others. There is not a boy or girl who hasn't read or heard about the recently committed crimes. Among the youth, the mind is open to all influences, and the impressions made persist for their entire life. A man bearing a magnificent gray handlebar mustache nods vigorously while brandishing an illustrated newspaper. I agree entirely. That's all we've ever heard about. The killer has become more famous than Richard Mansfield. We see murder posters on every street corner. The horrors of crime conceived of by the cruelest imagination are placarded on all walls and fences in the style of the oldest sensational prints or of the most vulgar penny dreadfuls. These mural monstrosities, uncaring of the crime, shine horribly among the filth and the dust, and have a terrible effect on the legions of workers, stupefied by vice and their passion for the gin they drink as soon as they get their pay, as well as on the already perverted youth who repudiate all constraints and live at the edges of our society, touching it only to harm it.
Lots of branded entries this time.
Come now, Wilfred, intervenes Langdale. You're being heavy-handed, insinuating that the press causes the calling to murder among the young. It's giving them little credit for intelligence and common sense.
But they happen not to have any, my dear friend, replied Wilfred with a sententious tone. Common sense is something you learn, and these little vagabonds from Whitechapel have no education. Their only rule is that of their perverse instinct, and their only goal is theft. It's a sad realization, certainly, but the horror of their appearance reflects that of their soul, and it's probable that we have one murderer per crime. We happen to have among us young detectives mandated by the famous Sherlock Holmes, retorts Langdale as he notices our presence. Gentlemen, what do you think of the dear Wilfred Robart's brilliant theory? That's it.
Pike is like,
excellent. Good.
Thanks, Pike.
Do you have a destination in mind?
I wanted to look up this one real quick.
I think we need to solve this or not in the next half an hour or so.
Yeah.
I agree.
I'm with you. I mean, I actually went through almost all the ones we've gone through for this one at least, and I still didn't catch anything that jumped out at me.
I don't feel like we're any closer.
No.
Yeah, no.
I am. So, given that, what if we do what Herbie had suggested and look and see what the questions are.
And answer.
Have been cheating all along. These are real glass. They are. I can't see anything. Sorry, Lois. Right? Okay.
Question number one. How did you find out about Bob?
Trying to figure out how this
like, if the first one is who's Jack the Ripper, we'll know that it's like, okay. But if it's not who is Jack the Ripper, then maybe we can stand a chance.
Question one. Who does Holmes think Jack the Ripper is?
Oh, man.
Seriously?
Okay. So let's pause.
Yep.
Just a moment. Do we want to just do it? Or...
Yes.
I don't know what else there is for us to follow up on.
No. I mean, doubtless we'll find out something about that when we get to the actual...
I'm sure we're going to find out lots as soon as we start reading this. Shall I go ahead and commence the finale?
I think it's Maria.
Alright, well, we can weigh in with our theories and such and see how it goes. Hi, Fukuyama. We're playing Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective, a game in which we try and fail miserably to solve mysteries.
We're about to lose.
We're about to lose hard.
we're starting 110 points in the hole.
Well,
we were a little...
I was more concerned with finding out who Jack the Ripper was.
Yeah,
seriously.
And as a matter of fact, there's only one question in the first series, which is who does Holmes think Jack the Ripper
points.
Is? Brandon, who do you think Holmes thinks is Jack the Ripper?
Are we able to consult his when you go back to him?
Sure, we can look at anything.
I didn't
anything
even
that we've
see
looked
that
at.
Whatever.
I mean, he
doesn't really hint anything.
He just says, there's a pattern... look at the other things, see which ones match up or which ones stand out. I think that it's someone connected to the police in some way, because I think that's the only kind of person that you'd see wandering around at night, and you wouldn't be suspicious. Got access to the scene of the crime.
Of the two...
But prostitutes run from police.
I think it's the doctor who's here, who had the unique letter... And a half of a kidney.
Dr. Ogle, Mortal. Did he send it to himself?
Yeah, because it was postmarked from a place that doesn't exist. You can't mail and get a postmark from E, and he got a letter postmarked from E.
Okay.
And he was the one who gave a different account of the autopsy versus the other one? Like, there were the two accounts, right?
I thought we had...
Oh, that may have been from a different thing.
Yeah,
that was Dr. Bond.
Yeah.
I still blame him, because he had the letter that couldn't have been postmarked.
Okay.
In a weird way.
It was Dr. Ogenborf, I think.
Perkenbergen.
Something like that.
He was so mad that he was misquoted in the papers, and he attached to the investigation by the police.
Yeah.
Would
have had medical knowledge necessary to chop someone up like that.
Is he in his 30s?
Let's look. We can look.
Yeah.
92E is where that guy lives.
I don't even know if he describes him. I think this is a major character.
Thomas Horrocks Oppenshaw, a middle-aged doctor with a severe look, is a renowned surgeon.
With severe what? A severe look.
Is a renowned... With a severe look, is a renowned surgeon.
I blame him.
Renowned.
Lobos, who do you think Holmes thinks Jack the Ripper is?
Based on the one case I've done with this and the very... scattered details I've gathered from today.
Yes.
It's me. I kind of agree with the generic somebody working with the police or for the police.
Yeah, I'm trying to find, am I even holding case one? I might be holding case two. That might be explaining why I can't find the entry I'm looking for.
So
I don't have
before
any
before we
cases.
Even look at this answer, out of mercy, I almost think we should all get to try one and we can get more credit if we're somewhere in the neighborhood.
That's what I'm going for by asking each person individually. AK and girl, this is an absolutely incredible game. I should note that we're playing the expansion. You should take a look for just the base game, Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective. You can get it on Amazon. What were you going to say?
That said we're about probably 2 minutes from a massive spoiler for the
yes,
main
that's true.
Campaign of the expansion.
If you're interested in playing the game at all, you shouldn't watch this series, nor should you watch our archives on YouTube, because the entire game is hearing the story and figuring it out. So if we have piqued your interest in it, I am very glad, but then you should stop watching.
So I was essentially looking at those two initial officers.
Yeah.
So Meisen is the guy who is like, everybody move along. And like that's, but he's never come up again.
No, that's, I have difficulty like.
And it's Officer Neil who has a mustache.
It is.
But then again, I don't think those guys will come up again.
It's like none of these characters, except for our points of contact, have recurred. The closest we've had is like recurring locations, like the frying pan. But even then, there's never been like, we encounter that old prostitute again. Where it's like, there's not anyone, like, In the Law and Order episodes, you always know that that guy that's introduced three-fifths of the way through the episode is the guy who did it.
Yeah.
Because that's when they introduced that character. In this, I don't know who's been introduced at that point. You know?
The meta plot doesn't fit. Like,
where is Hamburg?
But maybe they don't have an
I don't know where Hamburg is.
It is a generic, like, I don't know.
Home.
Right? Because
so,
there is no Jack.
I have two guesses. And the first one is that it's that one doctor. The second one is that there is no Jack the Ripper. And this is all an illusion.
That maybe this guy at the Society Club was right, and that there was... It's just the youth of London's Whitechapel district is not...
It's all those sea urchins.
Yeah, it's all these sea urchins rolling through the street.
Just I blame the sea.
So we have four of our five guesses down so far. We have a policeman.
Uh-huh.
We have Dr. Ogenborf. I have not corrected his name out of sheer stubbornness and because I'm writing with a pen tonight. We have a slightly different guest working with the police, which is distinct from the policeman. We have nobody as a
and
guest.
Everybody.
All right.
Now I need to come up with my guess.
Yeah, who do you think Holmes thinks is Jack the Ripper?
Okay, well, I'm still thinking it's not the police because we've seen that prostitutes run from police. They wouldn't solicit this
unless
guy.
Unless he's wearing a big fluffy coat over it.
Well, yeah, he doesn't always have to wear his police uniform. Yeah.
Or if he's a crooked cop!
All that workers stuff, though.
That's what I'm actually thinking. I want to put. I'm trying to find something a little more specific than commoner or worker.
Yeah.
Trainsman.
Oh,
push cartist.
Yeah, push cartist. Wait, I mean.
No, there's a guy who's like the groomsman who has access to the horses and the carts and the cabbies.
But someone who
sure, a cabbie.
But someone who wouldn't. Someone who's porting things around, maybe.
We didn't see him with a package once. When we were, like, in Chapter 3, didn't we find somebody with some sighting of him? He had a parcel of some kind. We thought he was
that,
the stamp thief,
but
it turned... But
no, that was the stamp
that
thief.
That was the stamp thief.
There was a guy who we had a parcel here that we thought might have been the... I thought might have been the knife.
It
but
was,
then he turned out one
clothing?
Of the... He was one of the people who visited beforehand, and he had the child's
clothing. And, like... I still think that guy is shady as fuck. Like, that might be that
we
guy.
Everyone's guilty.
We can go back and look at that guy.
Yeah, well,
sure.
I remember really being suspicious of him because he was bringing clothing, including, like, children's clothing or something. And there was, like, a... That was
oh,
weird.
Yeah!
That was, like, really
like
weird.
Kids' gloves or something
yeah.
like
yeah,
that,
he
right?
Yeah, clothing. Like, he was spotted with clothing,
yes.
And I was like...
Because something I like to point out here is we followed that big chain of people who all saw the last victim, and we kept thinking, this guy's the guy. No, it's the guy after that. No, it's the guy after that. And it's like, oh, it's a guy after the guy we didn't even see. But there's nothing that says that one of those guys couldn't have been the guy.
Yeah.
That's true.
Except that we never heard from any of those that guys again.
No, we heard it from a lot of them, actually. I think. Help.
That guy with a box of children's clothes is also suspect.
That is weird, but it doesn't make them Jack the Ripper.
If you carry around children's clothes in a small box...
Kirby, who do you think Holmes thinks Jack the Ripper is?
I'm going to go with...
Jeez!
Alright, I'm not used to setting this far to left, so I'm bumping everything.
Wiggins.
Oh my god! That'd be amazing.
I'm going to say...
Creepy Watson.
Workmen of some kind.
There are three second series questions. The first of the second series is one that we might actually have the answer to. Who is the Tam's dismemberer? John Gibbs.
Okay.
Yes, I believe so.
Yes, I can go with that.
Yeah, high charisma score.
Next up.
Number two of this series, why did he chop up the bodies like he did?
I don't remember.
So they would fit in sex.
Yes.
Yes.
Because that's his fetish. Small bags.
That's just your answer for everything, because that's his fetish.
Okay. Number, last one.
Who has in their possession the From Hell letter?
It's a doctor, right? Or no?
No, he didn't have the From Hell. The From Hell letter was... We talked to the guy who had it.
It's the graphologist, isn't it?
Yeah, the graphologist.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whose name is...
Bert Stevenson.
We'll give
him...
Bumberson Macklin.
It was in one of the newspapers. Probably the only
Thames. Tim Thames.
Jonathan Weatherwax.
Thank you. Weatherwax.
Granny Weatherwax.
Why does everyone in this country have a funny name? Are you guys ready?
Yes.
But go ahead.
What is that image?
Please be more.
There is a... It's something quite like what we have here. Showing the murders and perhaps some route information. Holmes reveals a board, a whiteboard, chalkboard, on which Jack's murders are noted. Watson looks at him perplexed. Holmes, we know all of this, but what can we conclude from it? Many things, in fact, my dear Watson. If we look closely, we can come up with three large time frames. The first, during the original murders, is around 3:30. At that time, the streets of Whitechapel are deserted, and it's an excellent time to commit a crime. The last pub patrons have been in bed for some time, and only a few workers begin to walk the streets. Chances of being surprised are much smaller, as are chances of meeting a potential victim. That's exactly it. Our man isn't looking for a victim. He's following a routine path and obeys an impulse when luck gives him a chance to. Our man therefore crosses from Whitechapel from east to west between 3:30 and 4 in the morning, using the streets along Old Montague. Tabram and Nichols had the misfortune of crossing his path. A second time frame can be drawn around 5 o'clock. Chapman and Kelly. So why did our man, after having crossed Whitechapel, still be in the west of Whitechapel at around 5? All of the pubs are closed, and only places to still be so active so early in the morning are the markets. The Spitalfields Market is actually near 2 of these crimes. Murderer, therefore, must have had good reason to remain in the area. A professional reason, for example. Not necessarily professional. It could have been a beggar from the market, no? Beggars rarely attract prostitutes. Even if they can't allow themselves to discriminate, they do try to make money. Yet even if we have a few witnesses, and even those are struggling to give us a reliable description, we know that our man engages in conversation with his victims to drag them to far-off corners. A thug, maybe. Once again, killing many prostitutes in such a spectacular way only attracts police attention. None of this is useful for thugs who, as a general rule, prefer to be forgotten. Believe me, these crimes aren't helping anyone in the criminal underworld. And if the criminal had been a member of these circles, you would have ended up in the Thames after the first murders. Bless you. No, gentlemen, who better than a simple worker to walk the streets at this time and seem invisible? A beggar, a grim-looking thug, or even a man better dressed than the neighborhood's inhabitants would have been noticed. A worker is banal, almost invisible, as it belongs so much in the daily labor of Whitechapel. I think that whoever the press has decided to name Jack the Ripper is a simple worker from the Spitalfields Market. Watson has a doubtful pout, but Holmes decides to ignore him. The last time frame remaining is the one from the night of the double murder, in which only Edo's case interests us. The witnesses are workers who are ending their evening in either clubs or pubs. The explanation is rather simple. It's the only murder to have taken place on a weekend, meaning on the night of Saturday to Sunday. Our man has thus quenched his thirst for blood, once again randomly, after his day at work and at an evening in a pub. And where is this leading us? There are thousands of people working daily in that market. I'm coming to it, Watson. There's another factor to take into account. The violence of the murder increases with each of these crimes. There's no doubt there is a matter to reflect upon for specialists in criminal psychology. As between Tabram and Kelly, the murderer keeps going increasingly further in his practices. I didn't pick up on that. I should have. Didn't. There's, however, an exception, and I believe it to be significant. Polly Nichols, timidly intervenes Wiggins. Exactly. The number of blows given to Tabram was important. In comparison, Nichols' murder was less violent. Yet, starting from the following murders, organs begin to be collected. Also note the proximity of the dates between the murders of Nichols and Chapman, roughly a week, meaning the shorter interval of the series. I think the murderer was unable to reach the end of his macabre desires with Marianne Nichols, and there that it was a source of great frustration. Yes, we know he was disturbed by a witness. It's a theory, Watson, but I have another, which seems to fit much better with the theory I've just described to you. Watson remains thoughtful for a few seconds, then his eyes widen suddenly. No. You mean that... Exactly, Watson. Charles Cross, one of the cartsmen from the very first murder, or rather Charles Lechmere, as it's his real name, is no other than Jack the Ripper. That's incredible. He was interrogated and even came to testify at the inquiry. Under everyone's nose. That's right. I think, however, that he didn't really try to taunt the police, but rather to manage the situation. Truth be told, he even gave a false name during the inquiry, which is already strange in and of itself. But let's take a closer look at these facts under this new light. Lechmere stated that he left his house 10 minutes late that morning, meaning 3:30 instead of 3:20. According to him, he discovered the body at around 3:45, a few moments before the arrival of Robert Paul, the other carter. First problem, Lechmere lives quite close to Buck's Row. There isn't more than 5 minutes worth of walking to go from his residence to the crime scene. Thus, even if he's really late, and nothing's close to certain, he got there at 3:35. So what did he do for 10 minutes in company of the victim? He didn't raise the alarm in any case, despite his lateness. 10 minutes is a pretty long bit of time. More than enough to kill Nichols and begin mutilating her before he was interrupted by the arrival of Robert Paul. But why would he have not fled as he heard Paul begin walking down Buck's Row? Flight was an option for sure, but not necessarily the best one. Lechmere didn't know who was coming down the alley, and it could have been a policeman who could have chased him, alerting the whole neighborhood. He also could have been caught by someone making their rounds, which would have complicated his story. Passing himself off as a simple passerby would actually allow him to leave the area without any problems and control the rest of the events. He thus started a conversation with Robert Paul, and then they left together to look for a policeman, to whom they told their story before disappearing into the neighborhood without even giving up their names. All of it would have been perfect had there not been a curious journalist who ended up finding Robert Paul's trace. Lechmere, who had probably been looking for the aftermath of this business in the press, must have read that article. To avoid having the situation degenerate, he then spontaneously presented himself to the police to give his testimony. However, he gave a different name and address, which, while it allowed us to find him, wasn't his home address. Rather peculiar, don't you think? Wasn't it risky to present himself this way to the police? Quite the opposite. The police, who knew that this witness existed, would have been looking for him anyway, and would have surely found him thanks to Robert Paul. He acted with a cool head, which allowed him to control the situation. And for all the other murders, as I told you, they all fit. To go to work, Lechmere had to have taken the most direct route, meaning Old Montague Street, which led him straight to Nichols and Tabor. After having taken delivery of his meat cart, he heads out to the Spitalfields Market, meeting in proximity to Chapman and Kelly. As for Eddowes, it's a case apart, as I explained, but we can note that the murder isn't located all that far from Pickford's. For the rest, our man has the required invisibility, has good reasons to stalk the streets these nights, and moreover, thanks to his work, he can have the luxury of doing so with a blood-stained apron without anyone finding that strange. I admit that's a good story, Holmes, but we have no proof. That's true, Watson. There's no existing proof of what I'm stating. However, our work doesn't just consist of demonstrating that man's culpability, but of confounding him also. He'll have some trouble justifying the hole of at least 10 minutes in his schedule, as well as explaining why he gave a false name and no address. And I don't think he'll be that enthused to have the police talking to his wife. It's up to Aberlane to put a final end to the story, but we'll no longer hear from the Ripper. It's only regrettable that I wasn't in the best of shape at the time of Polly Nichols' murder. Maybe I could have unraveled the threads of this macabre affair faster and could have saved a few of these unfortunate women. With these words, Holmes turns to the chimney and walls himself in a deep silence. No one dares to interrupt. We leave the room quietly to make Aberline a final report.
So to my horror, it almost sounds like we could have solved this with book one alone.
The thing that got me is way back in book one, there was actually... We were looking at the, that was when one of the guys said that it seemed like she was still alive.
There was some weird stuff about that.
We were suspicious of him back then.
But there was, was this the one where there was a ton of blood under her?
Yeah.
Her throat was slit?
Yep.
She couldn't possibly have still been alive?
Yep.
Yeah.
I didn't know those two things on one. That was...
I mean, not only was it 4 cases ago, but that was literally like 2 months ago.
Yeah.
That's rough.
Well,
yep.
We did it!
Sort of. Well, maybe we got some of the bonus questions more right.
Get ready. Charles Lechmere.
Well, how many points is the question?
100.
Out of pity, I think I can justify giving us 20 for the workman.
Yeah, well done, well done.
Well, we tag-teamed it.
Yeah, yeah. Second series, Who butchered the ladies in the Thames? Frank Seaman, alias John Gibbs.
Hey, what do we get?
Seaman.
What do we get?
A copy of Seaman for the Sega Master System.
What?
20 points.
Okay.
Why?
So they would fit in sacks.
Unlike Jack, he wanted to avoid having his victims identified as he knew them. He disposed of his sister's head in the furnace of the Queen's Pipe. 10 points.
Didn't get that one.
Nope.
Because her clothes were left. I thought it was weird that her clothes were left behind.
Yep.
None of her stuff was packed.
Because she was chopped into pieces.
They never explained why the fucking fire and the other thing was so hot.
Nope.
Maybe someone had just set the kettle down next to it and just left it there and... the last one.
Jonathan Weatherwax had the copy of the letter, 10 points.
Okay, and how many leads at Holmes?
Oh my god, 5 leads.
In the first case.
Well, good night, everybody.
Holmes solved this case with 5 leads. McCarthy, Lavoir, I don't know who that is.
The museum? That's in France. I thought you were mispronouncing it.
No, I never mispronounce anything. Hutchinson, Preacher, Pickford's. Free leads all of Disraeli's files as well as the Bethlehem Asylum. Kamansky is gravely disfigured, which clears Aberline's main suspect.
Okay. Well, we're discounting the 5 and the 3 ones we had.
Yes. Yes.
Over
18.
15 still. So we
pretty good.
We ended at negative 25.
All right.
All right. Okay. Okay. We did it.
We solved the case.
Good game.
They totally, wow. We caught Jack the Ripper. Thanks, Internet.
We did it.
I'm sorry, Internet.
No, I mean, that's the way it goes.
We did.
That's the one. Yeah, that's the one thing we never that ever jumped out of us was going back to people from the previous case who weren't directly mentioned in anything.
I just the level of discrepancies is so like removed from my current state of mind that I don't think even if we had reread those things that the like wait there's 10 minutes here.
There's so much
information
everywhere.
There is.
Yeah. You have to find the right discrepancy.
This is really hard.
Yeah.
Is what I'm saying.
Yeah. This feels like like several difficulty levels up from the one period.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like this is stupid.
I hope so, because
we couldn't figure it out.
You know what I blame is the medium who didn't give us the correct psychic vision.
I think, like they were wrong even about profession because I went all in on doctor.
I mean, I think a lot of Jack the Ripper retellings frame it as a doctor because of the sorts of things that that are going on.
But a butcher would work too.
Yeah. There's so many of the details. Yeah.
But they never describe him as a butcher, so I kind of feel like, oh, he had a bloody apron. Was kind of like a misstep there. Like if they had said, oh, this guy's a butcher, I would have been like, oh, well, I will at least remember your name, but. Like, the real name of this guy, Charles Lechmere, I don't know where that came from. I've never heard him refer to them that way. And...
And that was the one where there were 2 murders and you weren't even looking at this one as the main one, right?
No.
No, that was a single murder.
Okay.
Yeah, like, that was the first one, which literally we played in, like, February of 2014.
Okay, so...
I was a baby.
Aww. Yeah,
that's not true. I was... I've never been a baby.
That's a...
What is that?
I don't know.
Is that me grabbing at my mother?
No.
That's terrible. I can't believe you'd do that.
Can you?
Good game, everyone.
Good game.
Thank you for coming over. Thank you all for hanging out with us. We'll do better. We're going to do better. Next week's, I think, is going to be a much more digestible kind of affair, as it will be a return... I hope it'll be a standalone.
Yeah.
Maybe it'll be worse. I don't know. Who can tell?
Well, there's this part of me that in the back of my mind is like, I really hope they didn't just jack up the difficulty for everyone who like mastered the first one. Like,
Well, if they did, we'll have no choice but to let her rip.
Yes.
But we'll find out as we begin the second half-ish of the Sherlock Holmes consulting expansion, The West End Adventures, with another standalone adventure next week. And we'll see you on Tuesday for more Dungeons & Dragons type adventures. Thank you for hanging with us as we do a two-parter finale to this. I had fun, at least. You know, it's good. It's still a good game.
It was fun trying to figure like out, even if it doesn't work out.
I still think it was Maria.
I think we should arrest everyone. Yes.
Well, there were people calling for that in the newspaper articles.
Yeah. Like that Lewis Carroll.
Oh, yeah.
I've read his books.
Clearly.
Yep. All right, everyone.
I hear he's got a Vorpal blade.
Oh. Snickers.
Snickers.
Yeah. All right. Have a good night.
Bye.